with us on our last study on Wednesday night, you remember we dealt with a number of truths that dealt with and surrounded the truths concerning the sanctuary censer. And many don't understand or have not studied a certain vessel, if you will, a certain article that was used in the sanctuary of old that was called the censer. The censer. And it was used for a special purpose that we'd like to examine from a prophetic and biblical standpoint tonight and understand how it plays a role in teaching us truths in the closing scenes of prophecy. Now, before we go to our first scripture in the book of Leviticus, I want to just say a few words, giving our minds and our hearts understanding concerning some things I want you to go back and study on your own time. Now, when you look at the word throughout the Bible, censer, as found in the sanctuary, C-E-N-S-E-R, censer, there are various renderings of the word censer. In the Bible, there are more than one Hebrew word used for the censer. Even in the New Testament, there are various variations. But in the main scripture we like to use tonight, there is a term used in the Hebrew that we'd like to use to understand something about this instrument used in the sanctuary called the censer. The term is mata in the Hebrew, and it means a fire pan, a fire pan. In other words, the censer was a pan, or we'll call it even a vessel, to carry fire in. It was to carry or to take from one place to another fire. And it was called a censer in the King James Version. It's called a censer or an instrument for carrying fire, even hot coals, from the altar in the outer court, the brazen altar, to the altar of incense in the holy place. This was a work that was done daily. Now, interestingly enough, there is a mystery around the censer, which is also a point of our study tonight. When we look at the censer as opposed to the altar of incense, the altar in the outer court, the brazen altar, the table of showbread, the Ark of the Covenant, all these things in the book of Exodus and Numbers, there's careful explanations of how they were made. Very careful. But when we talk about the censer, there is no specific mention, specific outline of what exactly the censer looked like. There's no denoting carefully of what the censer was made like, except for the fact that the daily usage of the censer, the daily use censers, were made of brass and used by all the priests, all the Levites. And the Day of Atonement, there was a censer made of gold. Other than that, the fact that the daily censers being made of brass and the Day of Atonement censer being made of gold, there's no clear understanding of the shape or form or fashion of these fire pans or these censers. Could it be that when we look at this truth of the mystery of the very form thereof, that God, by not speaking about it, shows that the Spirit of God, or the spiritual emphasis God is placing in this important piece of sanctuary furniture, is not on the outward appearance, but on what was within. The sanctuary message here is showing us that it's more important about the censer, what it carried, than what it was. And if we understand what it is and how it played into end time prophecy, we're going to see the importance of the fact that there was no necessary nature or form or fashion of the outward nature of the censer. It was more important what was within than what was without. Turn with me the book of Leviticus as we open our study tonight. In Leviticus 16, it says this. Leviticus 16, because we mentioned, and let's show from the Bible, that the Bible says that this altar of the brazen altar, or the altar sacrifice, was lit with divine fire that was ferried or taken back and forth by a fire pan or a censer, which is our study tonight. In Leviticus 16, let's examine that. Leviticus 16, let's see what the censer was used for, carefully in the Word of God, and then we'll go back and look at what the fire was and the nature of the fire used in this fire pan or this censer. We're in Leviticus 16. Leviticus 16 and verse 12. Say amen when you have that.
Amen.
We're in Leviticus 16. Leviticus 16 and verse 12. Reading verse 12 and 13. Let's see the nature of use we see in this censer or fire pan. In Leviticus 16 and verse 12, the Bible says this. It says, "And he shall take a censer full of what?
Burning.
Full of burning, full of dead coals?
Burning.
Full of ashes? No, these are living fire, heated coals. They shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire, from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense, beaten small, and bring it within the veil. The work of the priest, of course. Verse 13. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony, that he die not. Now we know the 16th chapter of Leviticus is dealing with the Day of Atonement. Amen. The scene is seen where the golden censer is being used, and the censer is used to create fire upon the altar of incense to create a cloud of incense that as he entered in, as the high priest entered into the most holy place, he was not slain before the presence of the Lord. This censer, would you just take fire off of the altar in the outer court and bring it within the house of God to, as a fire pen, ferry the fire, move the fire from place to place to fulfill the will of God. The will of God in the sanctuary, the way of God was fulfilled and was accomplished through the use of censers. Without the censers, the work of taking this fire back and forth could not be done. The work of the altar in the outer court, being ministered onto the altar of incense or prayer, Psalm 141, verse 2, could not be accomplished without the use of censers upon the earth. And this fire that we mentioned, this fire on the altar of God that was taken back and forth, we found out on our last study, was not an earthly fire. It was not a normal fire. It was not a fire of earthly origin. What type of fire was used in this work of the sanctuary? Who remembers? It was a divine fire. It was a heavenly fire, because God himself answered by fire in the Old Testament, showing that he accepted, whether it be the altar of Abel or the altar of Moses, whether from Genesis all the way to the end of the New Testament, God answers by fire to show he had endorsed the message, the ministry, the worship of those that came before him. This was the way that God anciently, even today, showed that he accepts the ministry and message of his worshipers in 2018. Let's look at the book of Leviticus again. In Leviticus, notice it, Leviticus 9 chapter, Leviticus 9 verse 23 and 24. What type of fire was used on the altar of God and was taken into the censer and taken back and forth from the altar in the outer court into the holy place, or into the work of God in the sanctuary? We're in Leviticus 9. Let's see what kind of fire was used from the word of God. In Leviticus 9, it says this. Leviticus 9, verse 23 and 24. Say amen when you have that. Amen. When Leviticus chapter 9, the last two verses of Leviticus 9, verse 23 and 24 say this. Notice what kind of fire was used. It says in verse 23, and Moses and Aaron went into the tabernacle of the congregation and came out and blessed the people, and the glory of the Lord appeared unto all the people. Verse 24, and there came a fire out from before the Lord and consumed upon the altar the burnt offering and the fat, which when all the people saw, they shouted and fell on their faces. Here the Bible clearly says that this fire that started the work in Leviticus, started the work of the sanctuary, began to take and to receive the sacrifice and offerings, if you will, on the altar, was a holy fire. It was a fire from God's presence, a fire from the Lord. It was a work of God. It was not an earthly fire. So the fire pans or the censers, were they taking a normal fire? Or were they an instrument to carry holy fire, divine fire, even to fulfill the will of God in the sanctuary? Yes. Now again, let us make our minds dwell upon the fact that these fire pans or these censers or these instruments carrying the divine fire of God back and forth were called in the scriptures, of everything else, it was called a vessel. It was foremost a vessel. There's no explanation of what it looked like. No explanation carefully about other than the fact of one being gold and one being brass. There's no explanation of the nature or form of it except to say it was a vessel. Notice again in the book of Numbers now, how in Numbers 4, the Bible gives one of the most only descriptions saying it was a vessel. In Numbers 4, it says this. Numbers 4 and verse 14. Again, we're looking at the censer in the sanctuary and the implication it has, the understanding it gives for the closing scenes of prophecy. Are we in Numbers 4? Amen. Numbers 4 chapter. Numbers 4 and verse 14. What was the censer? It was a vessel. Numbers 4 and verse 14 says this. It says Numbers 4 and verse 14, this. It says, and they shall put on it. Are we there?
Amen.
And they shall put upon it all the vessels thereof, wherewith they minister about it. Even the what?
Censer.
Brother says, what was the censer? It was a vessel. A vessel used to minister. Brothers and sisters, can you see something here? That the censer was a vessel used to minister. This censer was a vessel used to minister, full of holy fire, full of living or hot coals from off the altar, to fulfill the will of God in the sanctuary and to allow the work of God to go forward. When we look at this truth, brothers and sisters, what is the Bible telling us about this mysterious instrument or vessel called the censer? Well, in 1 Corinthians 10, we see a message that we looked at previously. Look at it again. 1 Corinthians 10. Let's follow this message all the way through, point by point, those things that we know and that we don't know. 1 Corinthians tells us this. What do we know about all these things that we see, all these words and symbols and sentences that we see in the Old Testament talking about the censer and the work thereof and what it was doing as ministering as a vessel in the house of God? What is it showing to us in the closing scenes? Or does it have an application to us? Does it have a message for us in these closing scenes? 1 Corinthians 10. 1 Corinthians 10 verse 11 and 12 says this. It has an example or a teaching for us, a message for us in the last days. 1 Corinthians 10. 1 Corinthians 10 and verse 11 and 12. Say amen when you have that.
Amen.
1 Corinthians 10 verse 11 and 12. It says in 1 Corinthians 10 this. It says, now all these things. What things? All that happened with the censer. All the fire that was in it. All the work it did in the outer court and also in the holy and most holy place. All the power that it demonstrated as it was doing this ministry. All the ones that were made of brass or of gold. All these things. Verse 11 says, happened unto them for and sample, and they are written for our admonition. Whose admonition? Upon whom the ends of the world are. These things that we're studying tonight are teaching or showing or educating, admonishing the final generation. This is the final generation message seen from the Old Testament. It says this, verse 12. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest those living in the last generation, unless they understand these messages and the spiritual implications of the sanctuary and even the sanctuary censer and its implications and teachings for us in the closing scenes, we might verily fall. We might have a wrong understanding or application of how the work will finish, how and who will God use to finish the work, and how God is going to, we even say, take the work in his own hands. Shall we examine that?
Amen.
Look at another text. Look at 1 Corinthians again and verse 3. Let's continue the thought. In 1 Corinthians 3, let's see something carefully. We found that all these things are samples, right? They're teaching us, they're showing us things that happened anciently, even in the sanctuary, to educated people living at the end of the world. And when we look at this idea of the censer, we are understanding how to apply these teachings, these symbols, these evidences we see in the Old Testament in their application at the end of the world. What's the great application we understand from the sanctuary for the end of the world? We see it in 1 Corinthians 3. 1 Corinthians 3 gives us a tremendous understanding of what the entire sanctuary meant. If we can go to detail, even dealing with the sanctuary censer, but what did the entire sanctuary, this entire temple mean to the Christian according to these last days? 1 Corinthians 3 tells us this. It says here, 1 Corinthians 3 verse 16 and 17. In 1 Corinthians 3 verse 16 and 17, notice what it says. It says in 1 Corinthians 3:16, know ye not that ye are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? Stop right there. Did you miss that? What is the temple of God? It's the sanctuary. And the sanctuary, we are. The Bible says, you want to understand the great truth concerning the sanctuary of all the truth that are inside there? A great or super truth is the fact that the very sanctuary is a metaphor. It is a symbol of the believer itself. The fact that God from eternal ages desired to dwell in all his created beings by the Spirit of God is a truth of the gospel, a truth from Genesis to Revelation. And it's seen where? In the sanctuary. Paul says here in verse 16 of 1 Corinthians 3, know ye not? Don't you understand the spiritual nature of the sanctuary? Don't you understand the lessons for the last day, people, so you don't fall? Know ye not that ye are the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwelleth in you? If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy, for the temple of God is holy. Which temple? Now, we just found out, brothers and sisters, we just examined, we studied, we looked at some things, and we found out that this censer had divine fire in it. Amen? And it was used in the sanctuary to fill the will of God. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 3 that the believer is the sanctuary. The sanctuary was a symbol of what God desired to do in his people. God desired to dwell. The Bible says, and let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell where? Among them. And God says, not in the sense of the literal sanctuary, which was a shadow, in the New Testament, at the end of the world, where does God desire to dwell? In us, in our hearts by faith, even by the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, do you know that when we look at the sanctuary, the entire sanctuary, and the fact that God would dwell and rest upon the sanctuary and dwell in the sanctuary between the cherubims is a message of what God desires to do through the Holy Spirit in the believer. And what the entire sanctuary is teaching us is also seen in the censer. The censer, one of the smallest and almost the most least described instruments in the sanctuary, is a mini example, a small example of what the entire sanctuary means, which is God desires to do a work by dwelling in the believer, dwelling in them, or dwelling in them as a living Savior, as a living power to save both the person and the entire world. This censer, this fire pan, this fire-bearing vessel also represents the believer. Also represents who? Oh, the Christian, just as the entire sanctuary does. You say, well, how do you get that? Well, then we find out, according to the book of Leviticus chapter, Numbers 14 and verse 14. Numbers 4 and verse 14. Didn't we see in Numbers 4 and verse 14 that the censer was a vessel? Do you remember that? A vessel for the ministry or ministry in the sanctuary. Did we see that it was a vessel filled with fire or God's true and powerful holy fire, which gave both light and heat? We know because it was a flame of fire destroying the sanctuary services or destroying the sanctuary sacrifices. Notice what it says again in the book of 2 Corinthians. In 2 Corinthians, what do we see concerning the preacher, the person, the believer in these last days, even at the end of the world, that showed this vessel in the sanctuary is a symbol of what God wants to do in the believer, to fill him with divine fire. Look at 2 Corinthians 4. 2 Corinthians 4, we're going somewhere, listen carefully, we're going somewhere with this, all these scriptures and understanding. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 6 and 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6 and 7. Say amen when you have that. We're in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 6 and 7, we're understanding that the sanctuary censer was a vessel, and as a temple of God, as a symbol of the sanctuary of God, but a symbol of the believer filled with the Holy Ghost, that same truth is seen in the censer, which is nothing but a vessel for the fire of God. In 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 6, it says this, "For God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Look at verse 7. But we have this treasure where? In earthen vessels. We have this light or this fire of God or this power of God in these earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. May be of God and not of who? May be of God and not of us. That the excellency of the power, it says, may be of God and not of us. What were in these earthen vessels? Light. What was in these earthen vessels? Power. And what is the power that we found in the Word of God, in the New Testament, that would dwell in the believers just as the fire dwelt or was contained or carried in the sanctuary censers? What is this power? In Matthew, the third chapter, Matthew 3 and verse 11. You can write it down and read it if you want to. Matthew 3 and verse 11. Matthew 3, you should know this text by heart. Matthew 3, 11, the Baptist, John the Baptist said this. He said, "I indeed baptize you with water, but there cometh one after me, mightier than me, whose shoe latch I am not worthy to stoop down and unlatch. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire." The Holy Ghost is what? Spiritual fire. And in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, we're going to Acts chapter, we look at Matthew 3 and 11, that's Matthew 3 and 11. In Acts 1 and verse 8, Jesus says, You shall receive what? Power. After that, the what? Holy Ghost has come upon you. Are you getting these scriptures? Matthew 3:11. John the Baptist says, the Holy Ghost is asked unto fire. You receive fire by this one greater coming after me, which was Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ comes in Acts 1 and verse 8, and he said unto the disciples, you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost is come upon you. Now, 2 Corinthians told us that we have this treasure, we have this light, we have this power in earthen vessels. This power is the Holy Spirit. This power is the glory of God and the Holy Spirit that believers show forth, which is the Holy Spirit dwelling in the temple, 1 Corinthians tells us, the temple of God, which is holy. It's a symbol of the same truth seen in the censer, because the censer carried divine fire. You say, well, I saw that the Holy Spirit is power. I saw that the Holy Spirit is even a divine fire, a power. I see those texts, but we don't see the Holy Ghost being a real fire, do we? What does Acts chapter 1 say? Sorry, Acts 2 and verse 1 through 3 and so on. Acts chapter 2 says, on the day of Pentecost. Let's read it. We've seen it before. The Bible says that the Holy Ghost came in the early rain as unto fire. Look at the book of Acts. Acts 2. Acts the second chapter. Brothers and sisters, there is a definite evidence that God is attending believers. There's a definite evidence. It's not just in preaching. There are many people that can't preach but have the spiritual fruit. And there are many people that don't have the spiritual fruit but preach. Brothers and sisters, we need to have the fruit and the gifts. Many people don't have the gifts, and many people don't have the fruit. And some people have a little bit of one, and maybe not enough another. And we need to grow harmoniously, balanced. We need to pray for the gift of preaching, the gift of teaching. These gifts we can ask God for. But every believer should have the evidence that the Holy Spirit is filling the vessel, filling and abiding in the vessel. We're in the book of Acts, quickly. Acts chapter 2. You should probably all be there. Acts chapter 2 and look at verse 1. Acts 2 and verse 1. Say amen when you have that. Amen. Acts 2 and verse 1. Look what the Bible says here. In Acts 2 and verse 1, the Bible says that when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all in one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it sat upon each of them, and they were filled, verse 4, with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them. Fire. They were filled with fire. What kind of fire? Fire from heaven. What kind of fire lit the altar? Fire from heaven. What kind of fire was taken into the censer and taken back and forth into the sanctuary? Fire from heaven. Fire, or the Holy Ghost fire, filling the vessel, just as the believer is to be filled with the Holy Spirit. They are parallel truths. It's a parallel understanding of the information spiritually God must give to the final generation of what they need to be in order to stand in the final generation and not fall. These things are for examples unto us who live in this final generation, that we do not become deceived or tempted by the tempter or overcome by our own lust and fall. We must be filled with the Spirit. Brothers and sisters, we walk in the Spirit, we will make provision for the flesh. Know ye not that whom ye give your body to, yourself servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. Are we walking in the Spirit? Are we showing evidence that the Spirit of God dwells within us? All these messages concerning the Spirit of God and Him dwelling in us are seen in a symbolic sense in the stories of the Old Testament concerning the censer. When we look at the stories concerning the censer, last time we studied together, we looked at a very interesting one dealing with Nadab and Abihu. Remember that? And we studied, found out what the censer really meant last time, and we understood how it played into this scene with Nadab and Abihu and showed a message for the final generation. But again tonight, we want to understand this Holy Ghost power is showing a people who receive the Holy Spirit in the last day. Not Pentecostal early power, but the early and latter rain. A people filled with the fire off God's altar, or heavenly fire, the Holy Spirit. In the book of Acts, look quickly, another text. We read it last time. Let's read it again. In Acts 6, it says this. Pardon me. Not Acts 6. Isaiah 6. I beg your pardon. Isaiah 6 chapter. Isaiah 6. Look at the book of Isaiah. It's important that we understand, and return to Isaiah. Isaiah, the 6th chapter, that we saw in the book of Acts. Are we turning to Acts 6?
Amen.
Acts 6, beginning with verse 1. In the book of Acts, did we see that Jesus said, Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, it said that you shall receive power when the Holy Ghost comes upon you? What did he say after that? And you shall be what? Witnesses unto me in all the world, basically. Starting in Jerusalem, but into all the world. Why were they filled with the Holy Spirit? To be witnesses. Witnesses just in the church, right? No. Starting in Jerusalem and going into all the world. Why was the believer filled with the Holy Ghost or filled with the Spirit or given this fire from off the altar? Brothers and sisters, what was the censer used for? The censer wasn't used to hang up someplace. The censer was used in taking this fire to and fro. It was used, please listen to me, it was used taking it to and fro. If a fire from the altar was taken and is left idly, the priest would be derelict of his duty. How could a priest truly be doing the will of God and leave a censer full of fire idle? Full of fire, not using it to minister unto the Lord, to spread this light and this truth and this Holy Ghost power back and forth from in the sanctuary and without, in the court and in the heavenly sanctuary. Back and forth, there's a ministry going back and forth. These censers would go to and fro, and it represents a people seen in Acts chapter 1 that would do a work going to and fro. As a matter of fact, the Bible says in the book of Daniel, that many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Why? Because they'd be filled with the Holy Ghost. They'd be filled with the Spirit of God. They would be able to read and understand the Word of God, receive by faith Jesus, and do a work. The Bible says also, write the vision, that he that readeth it may what? May run. Run where? To and fro. They understand the prophecies, because the Holy Ghost will show us things to come. But again, the Bible says this in Acts 6, they are a people that are going to be sent to do a work. As the censer would go back and forth doing this ministry as a vessel for God, so in the final generation, God needs Spirit-filled people that will go back and forth doing the will of God, whether it be in the house or in the court. They must be doing a work continually, keeping that fire burning. Let's see in Isaiah 6 that this was the condition and experience of Isaiah. In Isaiah 6, it says this in verse 1. Isaiah 6 in verse 1, it says, in the year the king of Zion died, I saw the Lord. Also the Lord upon the throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above it stood the seraphims, each one had 6 wings. With 20 covered his face, and with 20 covered his feet, and with 20 did fly. And one cried unto another, saying, holy, 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 the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. I would even say through individuals as censers, taking that glory and power all over the world. It says this, verse 4, and the post of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I am in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then, verse 6, then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand. What was the use of the censer? To take live coals and to take them to and fro doing the work of the ministry. Verse 6 again. Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. Off the altar of God. It says verse 7 this. And he laid it upon my... In other words, that coal was laid in or placed into the censer, or into the believer that will receive the Spirit of God to minister about God's house. Verse 7 again. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this has touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged or cleansed. Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying. It's interesting that when the fire touches you, you can hear so clearly. It's so amazing how you can hear and understand so clearly when the Spirit of God comes to you. He suddenly heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then said I, here I am, send me. What did the disciples speak of and say when the Spirit of God fell upon them? They said, here I am, Lord, send me. They went all over the world preaching the truth because they were filled with the Spirit of God. They were evangelistic censers seen at the close of time. Brothers and sisters, we see Isaiah had an experience. that must be repeated in these last days. He had an experience that we see likened unto the work of the censer in the sanctuary of God. The live coals being used as a symbol of power of the Spirit of God that the believer receives, and as soon as they receive this censer, they don't receive it to sit down. They don't receive it to just keep it in some type of retired place of rest and so on. They are evangelistic. They desire to do a work for God and to go back and forth, to and fro, that knowledge can be or may be increased. They take this power from the altar and they go to do God's will. Brothers and sisters, you know very well, if you can imagine the work of the sanctuary, that these priests took this coal or these coals and filled the censer. It wasn't half full. It was completely packed, filled with hot coals from God's altar, filled with divine fire. And this altar, a brazen altar of sacrifice, we know in the outer court represents where Christ died or where the lamb was slain. Do we understand that? The individual, the censer, began his work at the sacrifice of Christ. The altar in the outer court was where the lamb was slain. And who can truly hear the message, who will go for us, or who can truly go with the message if they've never been at the altar? If they've never been at the altar of sacrifice and seen the merits and the principles and the call and the necessity upon believers because of the sacrifice of Christ, how shall they be filled? Many are filled with a spurious fire, a fire of fanaticism, a fire of false doctrine, and these things cause them the desire to do nothing but talk and argue about what is and what is not true. Those that are filled with fire, divine fire, Holy Ghost fire, from the altar where Christ sacrificed, where the lamb was slain, are filled with a desire to tell people about the love of Christ and bring people to the marriage supper, bring them to the king's feast. These individuals are filled with God's fire, not from a torch, filled with the hellish torch or false prophecy of Satan. They have a divine fire. And what they do as soon as they're filled, full with the fire of God from the altar in the outer court, they take that fire and they take it where? Into the holy place. The holy place, brothers and sisters, is illuminated by the candlesticks. Amen? It's illuminated or made bright. The holy place is not dark. It was never to go dark because the candlesticks would be continually burning. Now, if you look at the book of Zechariah, Zechariah tells us that the lamps or the candlesticks represents the Spirit and the Word. The Spirit and the Word. So those individuals are taking not only their spiritual power, or they only receive power or the Spirit because they see Christ. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. Even men that can be filled with the Spirit because they see my sacrifice. Acts 1 tells us, as many as received him, to them gave he, which was the Holy Ghost, or that fire. As we receive Christ at the altar of sacrifice, we receive the packing in of those hot coals, or we receive power. We receive that Spirit of God, and immediately receive it, we start to minister. We start to go about and share what Christ has done for us and show people how to come and get that fire for themselves. We become witnesses unto God, even in all the world. We come from that altar of sacrifice and we go into the holy place. The holy place is illumined by the candlesticks, which represent the Word of God, Zechariah tells us. And why is that important? Because if people try to go and take an experience and bring that experience into the altar of prayer, the altar of incense was the altar of prayer. Right now, you know Psalm 141 and verse 2. Psalm 141 and verse 2 shows that the incense represented prayer. If we go into the sacred place of prayer, even if we have a true experience, if our prayers are not illuminated by the Word of God, we will go into fanaticism. If our prayers are not illuminated and guided by the Word of God, by the candlesticks, and even close by that bread. Oh, brothers and sisters, can you ever hear people pray for things that have nothing to do with the Word of God? Are not based upon the Word of God? Prayers are not illuminated by the Word of God? Brothers and sisters, if our prayers, because remember, this censer was taken to the altar of incense. And to go to the altar of incense, if you look at the sanctuary, on one side is the table of showbread, on the other side was the light of the candlesticks. To get to the altar of incense, they had to go through or in between the light of the Word in the candlesticks, and also the table of showbread. They had to go through the word to get to the altar of prayer. And how many of us today receive not because we ask amiss? Or we don't ask based upon the word of God. We don't have the, as a matter of fact, it says in 2 Peter, right in 2 Peter 1:4. In 2 Peter 1:4, it says, by these exceeding great and precious promises. That's 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 4. By these exceeding great and precious promises, we are partakers of the divine nature. We cannot have the benefit of prayer that we need in these closing scenes without having the word. And having the word illuminating what we pray. The Bible says, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Those that don't receive the true fire can't receive the power to go into the sanctuary or to go into the secret place of prayer. Those that try to pray and try to petition God without the Holy Spirit can't even get in the tabernacle. Those that have the Spirit and go in and try to go in another way other than through the word, they cannot seem to get their prayer answered. And don't we need to have our prayers answered in this terrible time of Earth's history? Even in the closing scenes, don't we need to be a people of prayer? Don't we need to be able to pass through the word to understand what it is to wrestle with God? Those that went to the sanctuary saw the light of God. And in the light of God, they were able to navigate through the word. From the candlesticks on one side and the table of showbread, they would navigate through the word and get to the altar of prayer. How many don't take the time to spend quality time wrestling with God with prayer? They don't use the word as a medium by which they can offer clear petition and come boldly before the throne of grace. Even an altar of prayer to receive the merits and benefits of Christ's sacrifice. How many stay in the outer court? Hoping and waiting for a time where their prayers will be answered, and they'll never get to the most holy place if they don't enter in by fire and through the word to the altar of prayer. How many understand what we're talking about tonight? There's a need of a divine experience that the last people, the final generation need, and we see it typified in the teachings of the censor. But brothers and sisters, let's even make it even clearer as we close this message tonight, and a thought that I think has much to do with the final generation and the closing scenes of prophecy. In the book of Numbers, notice this. We talked about Nadab and Abihu the last time. Let's see the instrument of the censor used and spoken of in Numbers in this prophetic teaching seen in Numbers chapter, I believe it's 16, number 16 and verse 44. You remember Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, don't you? Mm-hmm. You don't remember that? No. Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. And the great rebellion of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. Let me ask a question. Were Korah, Dathan, and Abiram selected by God or elected by the people? We're in number 16 as you contemplate that. Number 16, verse 44 through 48. Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, those elders that rose up against Moses and Aaron, were they selected by God or elected by the people? You remember, if you look at the Old Testament, that there were people, these elders, that were elected to do a work in every tribe. However, God selected by his own word Moses and Aaron. Moses and Aaron were raised up by God. Moses and Aaron were selected and cast aside, put aside by the Spirit. And even though these individuals, these elders that came up, were given a portion of God's Spirit, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram began to covet and lust after authority and power to the point where they wanted to wrest the spiritual leadership of the church from the spirit of prophecy and from the high priest that God had chosen. Can you imagine that? They want to deny the high priest role in the heavenly sanctuary. They want to deny the heavenly sanctuary at all. They want to deny the spirit of prophecy and said it didn't have the power to define doctrine. Korah, Dathan, and Abiram said the spirit of prophecy could not define doctrine any better than they could. They said all the people of God are holy. We can do the same work that the prophet does. They had a desire to leaven the church. Did they leaven the church? When Korah, Dathan, and Abiram were destroyed by the hand of God, did the people say that they had killed the people of God? The camp had been leavened. The church, for a period of time, was under the influence of false teachers. The church for a period of time was under the influence of universities and institutions that were teaching wrong doctrine. There were churches that were presenting righteousness by faith as a principle of legal acceptance with God, and that we had no need of repentance and turn away from sin as long as we believe. People said that the health reform message was not important. We could do what we want. That all we need to do, as the spiritualists would do, all we need to do, like those that are pagans, all we need to do is believe. And this new organization that began had an effect upon the whole church to the point where the Bible says in Numbers chapter 16 that a plague broke out. Let's pick up the story in verse 44 and let's see how it applies to us in the final generation upon whom the ends of the world are come. Are we in number 16? Yeah. Number 16, we're closing here. Number 16 and verse 44. Say amen when you have that. Number 16:44 says this. It says, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Get you up from among this congregation, that I may consume them as in a moment. And they fell on their..." What did God want to do to his entire church? The remnant church, as it were, the apple of his eye. What did God want to do? Consume, destroy the whole nation. Or you might even say denomination. Because they were denominated people because God gave them a name. These people had come to a point where the leavening process of false leaders and false doctrine and false teachers had come to a point where God said he consumed the whole nation. Moses fell upon his face. Verse 46. It says, "And Moses said unto Aaron, Take a what? Take a censer and put fire therein from off the altar and put on incense and go quickly into the holy place." That's what it says. Go into the most holy place. Go into the outer court. It says, go out into the congregation and make an atonement. Write down your notes in Leviticus chapter 16, verse 30 to 33. In Leviticus 16, verse 30 to 33, it says an atonement is a cleansing from sin. To be atoned is to be cleansed from sin. The congregation had become deeply entrenched in sin. Sin had become common and normal in the church. And because of the influence of false leaders and false teachers and false prophets, these people, the people of God, were on the verge of destruction. It seemed that the church was ready to fall. The Bible says that these individuals were in deep sin. They needed atonement. It says again and on. It says, "Take a censer and put fire therein from off the altar and put on incense and go quickly unto the congregation and make an atonement for them. For there is wrath going out from the Lord. The plague is begun." Brothers and sisters, the Bible says the plague is begun and wrath is going out from the presence of the Lord. Now we should understand, if we're students of Bible prophecy, that the idea of plague and wrath we see in what book of the Bible? In Revelation we see the idea of plague and wrath, because the idea of plagues have two large meaning in the scriptures, especially when we deal with the prophecies. And one of them deals with wrath. Write down your notes, Revelation 15 and verse 1. You all know that text. In Revelation 15 verse 1 it says, "And they saw seven angels having the seven last plagues." Revelation 15 1. Revelation 15 1 that is. It says, "For in them is filled up what? The wrath of God." So the wrath of God is the plague that will fall at the end of time, lest some would have to fall. But also, when we look at the idea of plagues, in the scripture, we see the idea of plagues over and over again. And what does the plague, other than the wrath of God, mean to us? Plagues are always the result of sin. Always the result of sin. You can see all through the scripture, people receive plagues because of sin. And those plagues are various types of evil, even sickness and disease. Let's show you a text for that. Hold your finger in Numbers. We're coming back to Numbers. Hold your finger in Numbers and go to the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy. We're going back to the book of Numbers 16. Please hold your finger there. Put your Bible marker there and go with me to the book of Deuteronomy quickly. Deuteronomy. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Look at Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy. Hold your finger there. Deuteronomy chapter 28. Deuteronomy 28, Deuteronomy 28 chapter, look at verse 58 through 61. Deuteronomy 28, verse 58 through 61. Deuteronomy 28, verse 58 through 61. Let's see, not only are plagues the plagues of the last day, the seven last plagues, or the wrath of God poured out upon the impenitent, but also, when we look at the word of God, plagues are the result of what? Sin manifests in various evils, especially sickness and disease. But again, the result of sin. result of apostasy, a result of leaving God. In the book of Deuteronomy, it says this. Look at Deuteronomy. Notice what it says in verse 58 through 61. Do we have that? It says this in verse 58. It says, if thou wilt not observe to do all the words of this law. Oh, we go into apostasy, that is. Oh, the church goes into apostasy. That are written in this book, that thou mayest fear the glorious and fearful name, the Lord thy... Stop right there. Doesn't 58 sound similar to the three in his message? Fearing God and the glory of God. And it seems so similar. It says, if you will not observe all the words of this law written in this book and obey the fearing God and giving him glory, doesn't that sound familiar? Isn't that an end time application of that? But it's this verse 59. Then the Lord will make thy plagues what? Wonderful, and the plagues of thy seed, even great plagues, and of long continuance, and sore sicknesses, and of long continuance. Stop right there. How many plagues were in Egypt? 10. How many plagues in the wrath of God? 7. Now, brothers and sisters, it's called 7 last plagues, but do you know that there were 7 last plagues in Egypt too? Because when we look at the Egyptian plagues had 10 because the 7 last one fell only upon the Egyptians. God made a difference between his people and the Egyptians. But the first 3 fell on who? Both. It fell upon Egyptians, it fell upon Hebrews, it fell upon man and beast. The first 3 are a number of issues that dealt with sickness and disease. The fish died in the river came as blood. Frogs came on the land and they died and they stank and the whole place was corrupted. Flies and all these types of pestilence and disease, and even disease in animals were seen, as it were, because all these animals had death in them. The fish were corrupted. The frogs, even the animals, the cows and so on, were afflicted with flies and lice. All these things were the first plagues. As a result of sin, these things happen. And do you believe that there might be some first plague? Not the plagues of the wrath of God, not at all, because those things happen after probation closes. But would there be some drops from the vials of God's wrath or some first plagues seen in sickness and disease even in these last days? Do we see sickness on the increase? Do we see disease in animals again coming to the forefront? Do we see these same things that cause the people of God to want to leave Egypt, even seeing and causing us in these last days to want to leave even this world of sin? It says in the book of Deuteronomy that these plagues, verse 59, would be wonderful, and the plagues of thy seed or children would be even great plagues, and of long continuance, and so what? Sicknesses, and of long continuance. Verse 60, moreover, he will bring upon thee all the disease of Egypt, which thou was afraid of, and they shall cleave unto thee. Brothers and sisters, there is a connection between the gospel of salvation, the prophetic gospel, and the gospel of health. And I would submit to you that when we talk about this work of the censer, we can't ignore that there must be a work done in health lines as well as in spiritual lines to prepare people for the end time, or even to stay the plague that's come among us. Brothers and sisters, when we look at the book of Numbers 16, we're not talking about the 7 last plagues, because if the 7 last plagues was meant in number 16, there would be no bringing out a censer, because there's no work for atonement then. When the plagues fall, the 7 last plagues fall, has the atonement finished or is it continuing on? It's finished. It is done. When the 7 last plagues fall, there's no more intercession. There's no man in the sanctuary. There's no doing of any type of work for the salvation of souls. The mystery of God is already finished. So what plagues are being talked about here? The 7 last plagues? Oh, no, no. The 7 last plagues, there's no work of a censer, there's no salvation to be done for those who receive the mark of the beast. The people of God are kept that time, but there's no need of censer work. This censer we see in number 16. Let's go back to number 16 now. In number 16, this work that we see here, this work that we understand in the book of number 16 is happening before the close of probation, while the congregation still has a chance to turn around, while there are some first plagues. And because of sin and apostasy, because of sin and turning away from the book of the law, from fearing God not, and not giving him glory, not obeying his voice, and ignoring the health message that causes diseases, even disease of Egypt, causing sin, apostasy in various forms, spiritual and practical, all these things will leaven the church. Because of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, because of the sins of those at the head of the work, and the desire to put away an understanding of the true work of God and take the authority and make a new organization, this work of ascension will be needed in the close of time, just before the close of probation, just before the wrath of God is fully poured out. And even to stay the wrath of God, or to stay the plague that does not come too quickly, God must do a work. And we see it typified in the book of Numbers, chapter 16 and verse 44 through 48, in the work of Moses and Aaron. Let me ask you a question. Who was Aaron in the sanctuary? He was the high priest. You should know that. He was the high priest. Amen. And we understand that the high priest had a role in the sanctuary, especially on one day, the Day of Atonement. And we understand that Hebrews 8 tells us that who is our heavenly high priest in a better sanctuary made by God and not man? Christ. So in this last day, are we talking about Aaron or are we talking about Christ? Christ. And when we talk about this work, the Bible says that Moses, or the spirit of prophecy, says to us, or tells Aaron, or tells Christ, to do what? Verse 46. Let's read it again. In Numbers 16, verse 46. Remember, we're looking at a scene in the symbol of the sanctuary in the Old Testament that's shown in this language, showing us a work that Christ would do just before the close of probation, just before the pouring out of the plague, even to stay the plague and cause the people not to be overborne, and the whole church to fall because of the apostasy to come in by the leadership, by the elders of Korah, Dathan, Abiram, and Abiram. God would do a work so that the church, as it seems it's about to fall, would not fall. What would they do? What would the spirit of prophecy tell or show that Christ would do in this 11th hour, as it were? In verse 46, it says this, and Moses said, Numbers 16, 46, and Moses said unto Aaron, take a censer and put fire therein from off the altar, and put on incense, and go quickly into the congregation and make an atonement for them. For there is great wrath gone from the Lord. The plague is begun. And Aaron took as Moses commanded and ran into the midst of the congregation, and behold, the plague was begun among the people. And he put on incense, and he made an atonement for the people. What do we see here? We see Christ making atonement, or allowing the work of the atonement, even the judgment hour, to be effectual in the last moments of the closing scenes of prophecy. How? By God, by Jesus, taking the censer in his hands. By Jesus taking the censer in his hands and rushing into the midst of the congregation, because the plague had begun and the wrath of God was about to be poured out, and to stay the plague, Jesus takes the work in his own hands. And Jesus raises up individuals. What does the censer represent? It represents a people filled with the Holy Spirit, filled with incense, or the power of prayer, people with the Holy Ghost and with the ability, brothers and sisters, to fear God and give him glory, to give the message of the third angel in all power. And this work is a quick work. A final work is a quick work. The closing scenes will be what? Rapid ones. And here we see it says, it shows Aaron running into the congregation and making an atonement, or cleansing, Leviticus 16, 30 to 33, cleansing them from sin, allowing the efforts and the merits of Christ's sacrifice, because where did that fire come from? The altar of sacrifice. Causing the merits of Christ's sacrifice, or righteous by faith, causing the power of the early latter rain, the Holy Spirit, calling the truth of the message of God, even the three angels' message, to be brought in the midst of his church, because the church seems to want to have Christ on the outside, knocking to the entrance. Christ must now do a special work, and he takes the work in his own hands. And even though there were various people that might have done a work, the high priest takes his censer. The high priest takes the censer, and he now raises up individuals to do a work in the midst of the church that was not being done seemingly before. As a matter of fact, the Bible says that God would do a strange work. God would do a quick work and finish it upon the earth. Bible says these things carefully. But what does the spirit of prophecy say? The spirit of prophecy says that with such an army of youth rightly trained, how soon, even quickly, shall the work be finished? How soon will God, even with his trained army of workers, finish the work upon the earth? Even a quick work. We're told also that we're to send into the churches, or in the congregation, workers who can place before the people the three angels' message and the principles of health reform, this dual work. And she says, see if the breath of life would not return the churches, or that this plague of apostasy, this plague of evil, these sicknesses and diseases that are plaguing the whole world would be stayed. Would this even mean God raising up schools of the prophets that don't have any endorsement by Corey Dathan and Byron? Could this mean God taking the work in his own hand and raising up individuals that have the power of the Spirit of God that are not trained in our institutions, but God rushing in the midst of the congregation and raising up schools of the prophets, raising up individuals that have the true fruit and gifts, that are raising up workers all over, even causing the plague to be stayed and this apostasy to be, even to be a plague staying forth in the church before the end of time? Brothers and sisters, could it be that God, according to number 16, is showing us that there is a work to be done? Not the, will the whole church be revived? Absolutely not. Look what it says. Look what it says. It says in verse 48, and he stood between the dead and the living. Brothers and sisters, we are now between the judgment of the dead and the judgment of the living. Soon, we don't know how soon, the judgment will change from the judgment of the dead to what? The judgment of the living. Aaron stood between the dead and the living. Those that are doing this work of the censer will be doing this work between the judgment of the dead and the living, even to the end of probation. It says this. Now, verse 49. Will the whole church be revived? No. Now, they that died in the plague were 14,700, besides them that died about the matter of Korah. Brothers and sisters, many were slain. Thousands were slain at this time because they refused to stand upon the Lord's side. And they were slain by sickness and disease. They were slain in their sins. They were struck down in various ways because they did not see light. They were not able to make it even unto the time where God would anoint or atone for his people. It said in verse 50, and Aaron returned unto Moses under the door of the tabernacle of the congregation, and the plague was stayed. Brothers and sisters, tonight, do we understand that God desires even now to take his censer and rush in the midst of the congregation and to raise up individuals filled with the Spirit of God to stay the plague all around us? The widespread apostasy that we've seen even in these last, even a new organization? Has Korah, Dathan, and Abiram and their work leavened the church? Is there a need of grabbing the censer and trying to allow God to do a work within us, to fill us with the Spirit, allow us to be used as these end time censers, as it were, filled with the Spirit of God, given the power of grace, understanding how to put health reform and the three messages before the people, that the work of revival can begin in these last days? How many can do such? How many have the gifts and the fruit to be able to do it? How many have the self-sacrifice to take of their time and their opportunity and their ease to go to and fro with those censers, to go to and fro spreading light and divine power and giving a message that the plague may be stayed among us? Brothers and sisters, we're talking about the sanctuary censer in the closing scenes of prophecy. Where will we be? Will we be among those slain? Will we be among those that the high priest, that Christ can use as he stands between the living and the dead in the time of the atonement, in the time of the judgment, to finish a work? Where will we be? Will we be those end time censors? Will we allow God to do this work within us? Or will we allow all these messages about the sanctuary and the power of the gospel and the truth of the three messages to fall to the ground? Brothers and sisters, I have been convicted over and over again of the need of not only schools of the prophets, but also raising up schools of the prophets other places. I've been convicted years ago of the need of having these schools to allow the Spirit of God to come into the lives of individuals, because how many people claim to have the Holy Spirit, but they have no fruit? Who have they been a censer of truth to bring strength to that others have been raised up? How many people have been received the Spirit of God? How many have been converted or even baptized? How many have been brought into the ministry through these institutions that we see millions of dollars poured into? There must be because of these things. It must be because of the blindness that we see around us. Christ taking the censer in his own hand and raising that censer wherever he will to stay the plague. This is also why we have been making plans for years now to start doing meetings all over, placing health reform and the 300 message before the people and reviving God's scattered people all over that are even watching digital presentations like this, even to the close of time. There is a need of end time censers. And as the scripture says, when the Spirit of God places that coal upon our lips, if we'll pray for it, if we're seeking not for it, going to our secret closet for it, when that coal is placed upon our lips, we'll suddenly hear the Macedonian call. We'll hear the Spirit of God said, who shall go for us? And whom shall I send? And what shall we say? What will you say? Here am I, Lord. Send me. Send me. This coal has been shut up in my bones like fire. I can't forbear. I have to get the message in some way. That's why we can't let people go to the school of the prophet without doing a ministry. People say, man, I have to do a ministry. I'm going to school of the prophet to learn how to do a ministry. Brothers and sisters, if you're not doing a ministry now, then you're not ready for school of the prophets. Because only those that have done something and started to do something show some type of evidence the Spirit of God is working with them. School of Prophets is not an evangelistic meeting. We have School of Prophets runs evangelistic meetings. It's not an evangelistic meeting. It's supposed to be for those who have demonstrated that they have a desire to do God's will based upon conversion and a love for Christ. This is a necessary work for the last days. We need spiritual end time censors. And shall it be you and shall it be I in this last day? If that's your desire tonight. If you've seen or heard the Spirit of God speaking to you in a need of having a deeper consecration and being filled with fire from off God's altar, even laying all that you may be his disciple indeed, pray this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, tonight we see the need, our desperate need, of having your Spirit demonstrated by fruit and gifts. You've said that you would fill us with the Holy Ghost and give us power even to be witnesses. Lord, we need that witnessing power tonight, both in a Christ-like character and gifts by which we may disseminate and share truth with power. Lord, we pray that you would help us to cleanse our vessel that it may be right side up and cleansed to receive all that you would give. Pack our censer, our vessel filled with coals from off your altar, dear God. Truths from the sacrifice and power of the cross. Fill us with that Holy Ghost truth that we may dispense this light even to and fro that knowledge may be increased. Lord, help us through the pen and by voice to write the vision upon tables that he that readeth it may run and that we may multiply censers in these final scenes of earth's history. We pray that you would strengthen our minds, dear God. Allow us to, through deep repentance, through faith, receive all the grace needed to be agencies of change. We would be solutions to the apostasy around us and not causative factors of the apostasy. Help us to see and pray for our brethren, both on both sides of the aisle. Pray for our leaders, whether they be faithful or not. Pray for the finishing of the work, whether we see it happening or not. Lord, make us, prepare us to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true. Is our prayer with thanksgiving, even the forgiveness of our sins, tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.